and talks in general about the counter information system. So I briefly mentioned certain things last week, but basically just to repeat, we're going to emphasize the modern approach to counter information systems, how they're designed and deployed today, based on relational database management systems. So therefore, in this chapter, we present very, very quickly the so-called traditional approach that I mentioned last week that has been around for close to 500 years, and contrast it with the modern one. Now, an accounting system as a concept is wider than a particular technology. So if you look at the definition here, they list the so-called six components of the system, and the first one is not the technology. So any accounting system, no matter how it is created, has to capture information about important things that have happened in the business. So the ultimate objective is to know where you are, so how your business is doing. Right? So to be able to do that, you have to know what has happened. So you have to collect reports to and process data for this relevant information decision makers. So it's interesting that when we list those six components of the system, the very first component that we mention is the people who run the system. And this is probably one of the most critical distinctions of the emphasis of information system courses contrasted, say, with computer science. So computer science is focused on, say, on particular computer technology, right? Programming and how to do that. When we talk about information systems, we emphasize the fact that ultimately it's going to be people who are going to run the systems. And they're the most critical component in any system. They're also usually the weakest link in the chain. You remember that any chain is only as strong as the weakest link, right? And the people are usually the weakest link because, you know, as humans, we have some undesirable traits, right? So we get tired, we get distracted, we are not often consistent or reliable, and all those things introduce problems. So we'll talk later on in this class that you'll see that when we design the systems, after acknowledging this fact, we have to compensate for that. We have to do something that will provide a fallback position. And the second component is the procedures and instructions. So those rules that are put in place, so defining what has to be done, what is expected. Depending on what you do, you will be exposed to different sets of rules, but inevitably, no matter what you do, you will have to deal with certain rules. Then finally, we get to more technical issues, the data, the software, IT infrastructure. And we'll talk about that in the class. Actually, as I said, this term, I'm going to de-emphasize somewhat the infrastructure aspect. I'm not going to be talking as much about the underlying technology. And finally, we're going to talk about internal controls. Internal controls is a very big thing. We'll talk about the fact that now for quite a while it's a required thing of what the accountants do and the auditors do. It actually has been so for quite a while. People don't realize that. They often think about Sarbanes-Oxley. I don't know if you have heard about this, the Sarbanes-Oxley Act of 2002. Yeah, I know. But we'll talk about some other acts that precede Sarbanes-Oxley by something like a quarter century that actually represent that aspect as well. But again, so nobody denies that internal controls are there. So this is what AS is. And if you look at the slide, nowhere in the slide even mentions the term relational database management system, right? So it's completely technology new. It doesn't matter, right, what the underlying technology is. As a matter of fact, it may as well be clay tablets and the writing system that we use is the so-called uniform right, right? So I don't know how much you remember from your history classes, but you probably, you should know that this is how the writing started. And actually most of those tablets were counting credits. So it's not like you would see a description of, you know, great events, wars, battles, or whatever. So it's actually about business records. Now, you know that this area of activity is highly regulated. Well, first of all, you know that you all know that this is a profession, right? So you become a member of a profession, you will hopefully all of you will apply and get a license from the state, right? You know, you remember that the CPA qualification is actually a license that will entitle you to do things that people without the license cannot do, right? So, and such will be guided by a lot of different things, all the professional conduct and all this. Now, there are a lot of important regulators in this profession, right? And they've been changing over time. So, when we discuss what it is today, you will see that accounting is defined as an information system by the primary standard setting body for accountants. So what does it? No. What is the primary standard setting body? So when you're talking about accounting, I'm not talking about what accounting. So as accountants, so you have to follow standards. So when you are in the practice of this profession, you cannot just do as you please. You actually have to follow certain prescribed standards, and as it stands today, those accounting standards are GAAP. Okay, generally accepted accounting principles refers to actually a wider set. So there is a hierarchy of GAAP, right? So the accounting standards are at the top of that hierarchy, but GAAP is wider actually. So I don't know if I will have time in this class to talk about certain auditing aspects, right? But those of you who learned about Sarbanes-Oxley, they probably know that the final straw that broke the proverbial camel's back was actually the demise of Enron. But Enron actually, with all the shenanigans that they've done, they have not violated strictly the financial accounting standards. So they did do something that was against GAAP, but at a somewhat lower level of the hierarchy. But so what is this higher standard? So accounting standards are promulgated by the Financial Accounting Standards Board, FASB. You know that, right? And you know that actually accounting standards are older than FASB. So how old is FASB? Okay, you're not the first. FASB is not 50 years old. It's around. Okay. Accounting standards existed before that. By the way, whatever was decided, it has not, if it was not changed, it is still in place. So if a certain standard is old, if it was not updated and replaced by a new standard, it's still in place. So even if it is not issued by FASB, there was a board before FASB which was called ABB, Accounting Principles Board. Have you ever heard of that? Anyway, so when FASB emerged in, well, it was a good place, in the early 1970s, one of the first pronouncements was actually to define what the accounting is all about, and they emphasized that it was an information system. Actually, it's not surprising because by the early 1970s it was well understood. Okay, the computers have been around for a while, so it was well understood that it was clearly an information system. It was always an information system, even if you don't say that. But you know, there was a famous character of a French playwright, Molière, who discovered that to his amazement, he spoke in prose. you never, it's kind of like a joke, right? We all, nobody speaks poetry, right? We all speak prose. So it's like, okay, even if you don't say that the county is an information system, it remains an information system, because that's what it is. That's what the nature of county is all about. To capture, store, and process information so that the results of that activity can be useful to important stakeholders, decision makers. Now, so you have talked about a lot of different aspects of accounting. So you have studied financial accounting at LEM, you have studied managerial tax, and in all those courses, so you took this view that the information was available. Okay, so you're the provider of information, but there was no emphasis on the nitty-gritty of how you actually get that piece of information. And this is what this course is going to be about. So we're going to talk about how the information is actually collected, stored, and processed so that the results can be made available. Okay, as we said before, this is not programming, so we're going to be focusing on modeling, business-related data, and so we'll focus on those three aspects of information systems, how to actually collect, store, and process information. Okay. And by the way, this is now, parts of what the study will be on the CPA exam. So now, the double entry system that you studied was designed for paper-based technology. So paper was already readily available. People could write, they could use paper-based artifacts. So that's why we talk about accounting books, journals, and ledgers. And the system was really successful because it provided certain built-in control features. You know, when you do this double entry bookkeeping, basically what it means that you record at the same time the so-called debit and credit sides of the transaction, it forces you to double check. So again, as I said, humans are not really good at this. So we make mistakes, and when you end up and you see that debits do not equal credits, it tells you that something went wrong, right? So it allows you to catch a mistake early in the process before it propagates through the system and leads to some erroneous conclusions. Now, as I said, it's a great system. I mean, very, very few systems survived for such a long time, 500 years. But inevitably, it has its limitations. So since our technology for capturing, storing, and processing information has changed so much, it shouldn't come as a surprise that the system that was designed for one type of technology will not be particularly suitable to a different type of technology. So, what are the stakeholders of the accounting information? And you see here, so there are internal users, there are external users, internal ones are the management employees. Among the external ones, the first ones, again, it's not surprising that you see that the shareholders are listed first, because traditionally, most of the emphasis is on public accounting, right? So those companies that go to financial markets, this is the most heavily regulated the profession, right? So whether you work internally for such a company or externally, there will be many more regulations that apply to you compared, say, to working for a private company or auditing a private company. But there are also important stakeholders. So you see here, creditors, customers. It's interesting that customers are also stakeholders. Some people are surprised to see customers here. Why would the customer be a stakeholder of, say, company's financial information? What do you think? Is it correct to put it on that list? So why would the customer be a stakeholder? So would the customer want to see the financial statements? Yes. Why?
Because it's important for the customer to
Well, basically what you're trying to say is that, you know, when you have, say, purchase, transaction, it is not just an exchange at a point in time that terminates and has no consequences as soon as, say, goods are exchanged for money. So there are many different aspects of this transaction, right? Even at the simplest possible level, so you're buying a product, right? So you pay the money, you got the product. Why do you have to be concerned about the company? Well, very often those products come with a warranty, right? Will that warranty be honored? Will the company stand behind the product? Well, maybe they can't because tomorrow they go out of business and nobody will do that for you, right? So this is at the lowest level. So at a much higher level, what you mentioned, that actually very often your customers are not just individuals, but other business entities, you may be buying a critical component for what you are making. And that company may be an important supplier to you, right? So you may be, say, General Motors, and you are buying, say, a critical part of your automobile that you're making, say, an airbag, right? And that's not only you want to know that actually you're dealing with a reputable entity, but can you keep buying from them? Or you will have to redesign it because tomorrow they go out of business. So yeah, I mean, we can take it point by point and argue, yeah, those are all very important stakeholders. Now, interestingly, you see the government. And the government is a generic term. So it refers to all levels of government. Obviously, you have to deal with the federal government, right, for no other reason, let's say you have to pay taxes. But you also have to deal with state governments, you have to deal with local governments. So there are all those governmental bodies that you have to deal with, and different financial institutions as well. So all of those stakeholders have a vested interest in properly compiled, summarized, aggregated, and released results of business operations to know what has actually. Okay, so this is your standard accounting equation with a double entry system. Again, so double entry bookkeeping was designed to support this. And again, this is still incredibly useful. So you will see that our technology changes. Our modern systems will not be double entry systems anymore in the technical meaning of the term, but on the outside, they will still look like such. So you will still be able, say, to calculate the account balances, right? It will still make sense to talk about, say, particular account, what's their normal balance, whether it's a debit balance or credit balance, you know, depending on whether, what kind of accounts you're dealing with. So all that remains. So the difference is that it's going to be done in a totally, totally different way. So this is a depiction. It's basically just the flow of the standard accounting process. So we talk about it. So what does the account do differently? First, so when things happen, you create source documents, right? So you receive goods from your supplier, you create a document called goods received now, right? So that will document what you got, the quantity, the condition, and all that stuff. So that becomes one of the important pieces of evidence supporting the conclusion that actually you did get something and it ended up in your inventory, right? After you create those documents, you will have to create accounting entries. So you start with a journal entry. So when you get the goods, right? So what would be the journal entries? Typically accounts payable, right? So we're buying on credit, then we'll typically credit accounts payable, right? So those will be journalized. then you have to post them to the ledgers. And the purpose of posting, from a purely arithmetic point of view, is to do what? To make sure, so that as a result of posting, the account balances will be updated with the amounts of this transaction, right? So that your account balances will be up to date. By the way, I don't know if you discussed the fact that when you had a paper-based system, posting typically happened later. Are you aware of the fact that actually that you created journal entries, and then for a while, that information would exist in the journals only, and posting would be done only periodically, right? Maybe done, I don't know, at the end of the week, depending how you do now. During that period of time, the balance on the ledger accounts was not up to date. So there was a delay, you realize that, right? Is everybody, or you don't even think about things like that, right? So you think that, well, it went into the system and miraculously the balance is updated. Well, if you're dealing with a large enterprise that has to use paper-based artifacts, it is simply not feasible to do that. So real-time posting is a fairly new feature of accounting systems. I would say that realistically, in most cases, it's probably only about 30 years old. And until then, it was not really done. Yes, today, I mean, when you interact with a computer system, it goes into the computer, and you say, well, why wouldn't an account balance be updated right away, right? Well, this is something that the computer knows about. Well, then you prepare trial balance, right? And you see the journalizing post, adjusting entries, right? So why is it so important in our system to talk about adjusting entries? Yeah, but that's because we do our accounting in a particular way. So when you take care of your personal finances, right? So you are old enough, I don't know, I assume that you all have to file your tax returns right now, correct? Did you file your own tax returns? It's basically like a kind of a financial statement, right? Just prepare for the tax purpose. Then you have to worry about adjusting entries for your personal finances. Usually no, because when you do your personal finances, it is done on what basis? There are two different types, two different bases of accounting. You can do accounting on cash basis, and this is how you do your personal stuff. Or you have to do it on the accrual basis, right? So when you use accrual account, right, adjusting entries become critical. So if you did it on cash basis, so you had some piece of equipment, which is your capital investment, right, your fixed assets, it works, right? When it breaks down, you have to scrap it and replace it with somebody else, right? And that's it. Now, when you do accrual accounting, one kind of adjusting entries, you have to record post with your what? Depreciation, right? Which recognizes the fact that actually when you keep using that equipment, it's getting used up, right? So the problem is that we don't really know how much it has used up, right? So therefore, the kind of depreciation, the kind of entries that you make as an accountant, because you have to do accounting, is basically just one. Well, what relationship does it have to the actual deterioration of the piece of equipment that you are depreciating? Yes, when you actually calculate the depreciation, you have to estimate the useful life of that piece of equipment, the residual value, right? And then also you have to use one of the allowed depreciation methods, right? Well, accumulated depreciation is this compressed income, right? That's something that when you actually calculate a hit against depreciating entry for the period. Well, it will be, yes, but also as a result of that, you keep accumulating depreciation, which is a compressed income, right? But basically what I'm trying to say is that it's not the actual thing, okay? It's just an estimate. And this estimate may be fairly inaccurate. Because we have no way of knowing the so-called quote-unquote real depreciation, which people call in this literature economic depreciation, right? So there is a difference between economic depreciation and accounting depreciation. So in some cases, there may be certain things. So for example, even though it's still an estimate, but you know, an airplane engine, which is rated for a certain number of hours, right? And after that, you have to do something. So there, the number of hours of working would give you a fairly good estimate of what is going on with that engine. But in most cases, when you're dealing with your fixed assets, so important piece of equipment, you make a fairly arbitrary estimate, right? Whether you use straight line depreciation, double decline, balance, or whatever, right? There are many different depreciation methods, which are, but they are all very arbitrary, but that's why still it is important to us to recognize that we are actually using our close assets, right? Even if nothing has happened yet. So you keep using that piece of equipment, didn't break down, right? But we are still recording for depreciation. So prepare a trial balance, prepare financial statements, then you have to do closing. Close accounting period. When you close accounting period, you basically do what? Revenue and expense accounts, right? So revenue and expense accounts are basically those transferring entries where you keep accumulating it for a period, right? At the end of the period, you close them to.
This cancel each other out.
Close them to retained earnings. And basically, as a result of this closing, you zero them out. So they're ready to start accumulating the amounts for the next year. So that's basically what you do. That's the standard accounting cycle, custom made for paper-based artifacts. There are problems. So what are the problems? Well, inevitably, when you use a paper-based technology, you are limited in the amount of detail, how much you can actually capture. Even if you are particularly conscientious, right? And you try when you create a journal entry, you record in that entry all the minute details about the event that happened. It is not going to be of much help because it will remain written on a page of a paper journal. So even if, say, I don't know, you sold a man's shirt, okay, for $20, okay? You make a journal entry. In a typical situation, this is what you will record there. Okay, one man's shirt. Sold $20. Right? Which will be enough for you from the point of your financial account. So it will be sufficient to calculate the contribution of this event into the results of your operations so that you can properly prepare the financial statements. Well, there are some other important aspects of what. For example, the size. I don't know, you may want to record it in detail, say size 34, whatever. Or maybe less detail, say small, medium, large, extra large, whatever, doesn't matter. But undeniably, the size of the shirt is important, right? Not for the financial statement, but for what? Yeah, and but again, inventory taken from that point of view. So if you assume that, you know, okay, different amount of material is used to, say, manufacture shirts of different sizes, but the costs are usually trivial. So let's say, but let me put it this way, I have never encountered a case where shirts of different sizes cost different amounts. They all sell for the same amount, right? So, as long as you are concerned with the balance on the inventory account, would it make a difference what size of the shirt you just sold? Wouldn't change the balance, right? It's exactly the same amount. So is it important to report the size? Is it or is it not? So you are recording what happened. So you run a store, right? A merchandising business. You buy inventory for sale and then you sell it in retail. So do you want to record the size of the shirt? So pretend for a second, that's your store, you run the business. Do you want it or you don't?
It depends.
As we said, so what do you mean by inventory? If you take the traditional financial accounting view of inventory, right? So what is inventory? It's a dollar amount, right? So, and I just argued that as far as the dollar amounts are concerned, does make any difference. It's going to be exactly the same amount. Is it? So you run the store. Do you want to record the size of the shirt? Why? So it makes perfect sense for you to record the size of the shirt. It's worth the effort, because you will know which ones sell. Why is it important for you to know? Well, not only you want to increase sales, but when the next customer walks in and wants to buy the shirt, you want to make sure that, for example, if size medium sells the best in your area, you want to make sure that that size medium is in stock. Because it would be a real bummer if the customer walks in and they see extra large and small. And that's it, right? You're going to lose your sale. So you are an important stakeholder. Right? So we're talking about the fact that there is what looks like to be a critical attribute of an event that just happened. And it also sounds like your traditional paper-based accounting system is not really made to capture that information and inform you about that information, right? So if you think about those traditional accounting artifacts, maybe the journal entries, the ledgers, and so on and so forth, they will inform you about the financial consequences of what has happened, right? And yes, it is important for you to be able to report faithfully on the financial consequences of what has happened. But we are not just interested in the past, right? It's not really about history. It is also about the future, right? So it should allow you to run your business better. And it's undeniable that conventional paper-based accounting artifacts would not have much. So not only that you'll see again, we talk about, so this is just the transactional orientation, so it doesn't require, I'll talk about that other event, but also limited access to information. Imagine that I said, imagine that you have a very conscientious accountant who actually recorded the size of the shirt sold in the sales journal. So what? Okay, it is recorded there. So a really good person, you hired an excellent person to do that record keeping for you. Excellent bookkeeper. So they captured the information. It is in the journal. Then what? What are you going to do with that? How are you going to do it? How are you going to use it? Well, you want to use it, right? Because you want to know what sells. What does it take for you to know what sells? So, for example, in this case, what I'm talking about, that you want to look at your sales records, right? And prepare a report telling you that I sold so many shirts of this size, so many shirts of this size, so many shirts of that size. Right? This is basically, is it clear what I'm talking about? So this as a person who runs the store, this is what you want to know. Okay, how can you get that, what we call report, from your accounting system? So you'll hear this word again. So when you're creating accounting systems, most of the time what you will want to get out of those systems are different types of reports. So this is one of them. So by size, how can you get it out of the paper-based accounting system? And let's say again, and this is a big assumption which usually will not hold, but for the sake of an argument, let's pretend that your very good accounting clerk in the case of every sale recorded in the journal, in the sales journal, the size of the shirt that was sold. So you remember we are talking about capturing, storing, and processing information, right? So the information was captured so that the clerk who reported here or she registered the size and stored it in the journal. Now you have to process it. Now you have to do what is the processing here? Well, in this case, the processing happens to be really simple. It's just aggregation. So you have to add up all those sales by the category, by the size of the shirt. How can you do that? I mean, mechanically, what do you have to do to get that information? You run the store. Okay, I don't want this course to be just an abstract discussion. Just try to put yourselves in the shoes of those people who actually do this. So then you will see what their predicament is. So what do you have to do? No, the information is in the system. What does it mean in this case? So you have a sales journal. Do you remember what a sales journal is? It's a book, right? Where you record in a chronological order all the sales transactions. So it's literally, it's like a thick book where on every page you have sales records, one after another. So now, I want to know the totals. Yeah, but how do you add them up? So you have to take that sales book. And the general ledger is not going to help you. Okay? And no subsidiary ledger is going to help you either, because you don't maintain any ledgers for the size of the shirts. Well, you can do physical inventory. Yeah, this is actually how people do this, because it is still easier than go page by page and record by record. But do you know how laborious this physical inventory count is? Oh, absolutely. Surprise, surprise, even today, periodically, you still see people do physical inventory counts. I have seen it fairly recently. It's going to disappear. So we have some other technologies which makes it obsolete. Again, I used to talk in this course about some older FID. I don't know, we probably will not have time for that, but basically you can have embedded tiny chips in every item that you keep in your inventory. And you can have a base station, a reader, that can wirelessly pull those chips and know what is on the shelves. So it's not a new technology, really. It's, again, something at least 15 years old now. But yeah, now it's pretty common. So, but what I'm saying that the way that pay-for-pay system works is not designed to facilitate this. Even imagine, okay, you say, okay, let me keep separate accounts somewhere in my inventory book of the sizes. Then the next complication comes. You know, those dev shirts, they come in different colors. So what do you sell? Okay, you know now you sell a lot of medium shirts. And okay, do you sell them in white? Do you sell them in gray? Do you sell them in pink? So which ones? So, and again, you know, it's, and I can keep piling this on and on and on. So what I'm saying is that it's an intrinsic limitation of a paper-based system that it is not it could not be designed to capture all the possibly relevant details about business plans. And even if it captured them, it was not really designed, it was not feasible really to process all those details. And you'll see that this is what the modern technology allows us to do. That you can design your system to capture all that. And by the way, this has been done for a long time. You don't even have RFID. You know that your labels on the products have had those so-called barcodes for God only knows how long time, right? And you know that all, pretty much, even in mom and pop shops these days, you have point of sale systems with barcode scanners, right? So it's not even a manual process anymore. And that barcode can encode all the relevant information about the items, right? And it goes automatically to the computer system, and everything is processed. So you don't have those limitations. But again, if you're talking about paper-based systems, yes, it is just basic financial transactional orientation. Just financial data. It had to be periodic, because otherwise, you would have to spend an inordinate amount of money to have more frequent reporting. Now, keep in mind that the accounting function is a support function. Okay? So when you are talking about these different parts of the enterprise, I don't know if you've heard these expressions, profit centers and cost centers. You have never heard this. So accounting is basically, it's a cost center. So because you're just paying money for them. So you have to be careful because you cannot be frivolous about how much you spend on this support. Otherwise, you are not going to stay in business. So the information is, the access, even if the information is there, it is limited. The access is limited by the paper-based technology. And do high level aggregation. So you add up numbers, right? So it is very difficult to go back to basic disaggregation. And you will see that the premise of the modern systems is to do no filtering, no aggregation, nothing. To capture unfiltered, raw business information at the source. So this is what the modern systems do. And why are they designed like that? Because processing digital information is incredibly cheap. It costs very little money. So in the old days, you had to have highly trained individuals who were very good at arithmetic. Right? So for a long time, our civilizations were at a stage where this skill of actually being good at doing arithmetic was at a premium. And these days, it's nearly worthless, right? Because a computer will outdo anybody, right? It's like, you know, like in the old days, there were some very capable people who could run very fast. But the ancient Greeks used those runners to send messages. Nobody can outrun an automobile. Right? So this is what the technology does. Okay, so computerized booking. I briefly mentioned that. Remember I talked about QuickBooks, I talked about Peachtree. So we'll talk a little bit about the history of computing and accounting. But one of the developments was to computerize standard accounting activities, starting with the accounting platforms. So you can actually replicate all accounting books in a computer. That's basic fact. So some of the low-end accounting packages did exactly that. And of course it helps. Why? Well, because the arithmetic is perfect. The computer is never going to get tired. If you program it correctly, there will be no mistakes. But, it's, even though it will be better than a paper-based system, it's not going to be much better. Because you're basically, what you're doing, you're taking a design which was optimized for a different technology and blindly migrating it into a totally new technology with totally different capabilities, right? So even though, of course, it was faster, and by the way, when they did this, this is when posting became truly real time. Even with that, there was another important element. Actually, I'm cheating you a little. Even with computerized bookkeeping, there was a period of time when posting couldn't really be real time. Why? Because there was a problem with networking. So you had different parts of the system in different areas, and to get to a real time posting system, they had actually to do posting at more or less the same time. Early networks had troubles with that. So there was a short period of time when even the computerized bookkeeping systems couldn't really do real time posting. It changed fast. So then they started doing real-time posting, fine. I mean, your balances are today. But it helps, but not much beyond that. The good thing about computerized bookkeeping was that in most cases, companies didn't have to worry about creating them themselves. They were packaged software, so get them ready. But then there was actually a different development. So standard computerized bookkeeping systems were built only for really small enterprises. This is not how the accounting systems developed. The development of the accounting systems actually started with very large enterprises, not with very small. Very small enterprises were latecomers in the computerization area. So the pioneers were inevitably all big guys, very, very big guys. Why? Well, because it was a very expensive technology. When business computing started, it was incredibly expensive. Does anybody have any idea when the applications of computers in business started? That was not the first application for electronic computers, right? So what do you know about the invention? When were they invented, electronic computers? Does anybody know how old they are?
The
first computer I programmed occupied a room of half this size. That was when I wrote my first computer program in the fall of 1978. The computer I wrote it for was like this. Yeah, but so when were they invented? So nobody's interested, right? So you're used to it, you think they've been around forever. That's not true. So, by the way, this is a hotly debated fact. There are several competing stories about the invention of the first electronic computer. But the most widely accepted story was that the first general purpose electronic computer was ENIAC, which became operational in 1945. Well, calculators existed for much longer. So, the versions of mechanical calculators, certain versions, were already in existence in the 19th century, mechanical calculators. So, when I talk about computers, I talk about electronic computers, computers in the modern sense, where you have electronic elements inside, right? And they store information in the state of those elements, right? And this is how this will be controlled. So, I talk about electronic computers. So electronic computers are about 70 something years old. And again, people will argue, so the Brits will argue that, well, a couple of years before ENIAC, they already used something called Colossus, which was a kind of an electronic computer, not quite general purpose, but close enough. And there is another group of thought which said, well, actually it was 1939, and the first computer was created by Amanasov, which was an engineering professor in the Midwest. But again, so we're talking, you know, 39 or 45, so 6 year difference doesn't really make any difference to us now, right? So what is important that electronic computers were invented for what purpose? So what were they used for? Were they created to run businesses? No. No business would have enough money to fund such an invention. Because at that time, you know, that the costs were staggering. Not exactly like, say, landing on the moon, but really, really high. So what was it for? So what do we, even today, what do we pay the biggest price for? What? Yes, for killing each other, right? So this is what costs by far the most. Right? Just think about the cost of an aircraft. So the computers were designed actually to fight the war. So the Brits used it to break the German military code. So this is what is popular even today about the encryption of all that stuff. Right? So that Colossus was actually designed for that and was somewhat special purpose. Now, ENIAC was actually designed for a different purpose. It was designed to do the calculations for the atomic bomb project. Okay, so that required a lot of calculation and that cost a lot of money. So, those early computers were all funded by the government. And they were extremely expensive, required tremendous expertise. So what do you think business people thought about? You know, there was this famous quote from 1948. So I told you ENIAC became operational in 1945. So there was a quote from 1948 from a person called Thomas J. Watson Jr., who said that he would see a world market maybe for four, maybe for five computers. Why is it significant? Why does anybody care today what Thomas J. Watson Jr. said in 1948 about? Do you know what was his position in 1948? Thomas J. Watson Jr. No. Not upset. He said that he thought that there was a market for computers, but maybe for you could sell four computers, five computers worldwide. This is what he thought in 1948. Well, they were expensive. Everybody knew that. But why is it important that? So nobody has heard about this guy. Have you heard about Watson that won Jeopardy? Yes. Why is it called Watson? What? Yeah. And why is that? No, because Thomas J. Watson Jr. in 1948 was the chief executive officer of IBM. Now, that was in 1948, and years later, IBM was already in the process of selling some of the main flavors around businesses, yes.
I thought IBM was started around the 80s by three guys that was, they did the first initials of their last names, and...
No, that's not. IBM is actually a very old company. It is more than 100 years old. And the greatest breakthrough of that company early on in their career was that they did what? Obviously, they didn't start with computers. There were no electronic computers back in the US. So IBM was selling calculating machines to the US. So they invented the so-called punch card. So they invented mechanical devices to collect calculating information. And the biggest customer was the US Census Bureau. You know that it is the law that every 10 years we have to have a census, and that requires collecting and aggregating a lot of information. This is how IBM actually became a really big entity. But then they realized, even though Thomas J. Watson Jr. in 1948 thought that computers are not really their business, very soon they realized it was. And as a matter of fact, the largest computers in the early stages of this development that were utilized in business were all in the so-called IBM mainframe. So the application of computers in the big business started in the late 1950s. About, I would say, 15 years after the first date, when you know that the first computer was used by the government, was very expensive, but then, as you see, this technology prices started coming down, and IBM started making computers. Now, what is interesting is that the first applications were highly specialized. Why? Because it was very difficult to work with computers. It was very difficult to code. So it cost a lot, the computer cost a lot, programming cost a lot. As a matter of fact, the computers cost so much that a huge part of IBM business for a long time was actually leasing those computers. So companies didn't have money to buy them. They had to lease them. So IBM was leasing a lot of their computers, so that was a part of their business model. But the problem was that, you know, it's not like it is today where you see all those programs written for that knows what. It was really, really difficult and costly. So to justify that, you had to have certain applications where the computerized system that you create has to do something which is extremely voluminous, that requires a lot of calculation, where if you don't use electronic computers, you would have to use a lot of people with mechanical calculators, an army of people that you want to replace. And something that you have to do all the time, not just one of a kind deal where, okay, you need to calculate something, but then you're done. No, you have to keep doing it in very, very large volumes. This is what the first computers were used for. So if we talk about the accounting, the primary candidate, and this is where actually the first computerized programs became used in accounting, would be what? So if you think about a large company, which has to do a lot of accounting processing, fairly routine, by the way, more or less standardized, where you can prescribe. So you do this, you do this, you do this, you do this, and you keep doing it and doing it and doing it all the time. So what comes to your mind? What kind of accounting actually does this? And let's say you're talking about a company that employs, I don't know, 100,000 people. Since I'm running out of time, and I really need to finish chapter one today, I'm going to tell you. So when you're dealing with very large companies, say you have weekly payroll runs that require tremendous amount of calculation, right? So you accumulate the hours, you see what the rates are for different people, you see what the deductions are, how much you have to deduct, process it, print the payroll checks. Just think about this task for a very large company. Okay? So you can imagine for what kind of companies that would be cost efficient. So they were, only the largest people, the largest guys started doing this. And they started writing those programs in a special purpose language called COBOL. Well, actually, let me correct myself, because the language is a general purpose language, but what was primarily used for business calculations. So you can run an arbitrary program in COBOL, any program. You can do arbitrary calculations in COBOL, but it is not convenient, say, to do scientific calculations. So nobody used COBOL to do scientific calculations. There was a different programming language for that called Fortran. Okay? But as far as, and again, they're both general purpose languages, they're universal in that regard. So when I said special purpose, I misspoke. Because you can use it to run arbitrary programs. But the fact of the matter is that it is best suited to write business programs. And this is what is primarily used for. There have been actually a number of different versions of this language. The surprising fact is that it is still around. Believe it or not, when I was, well, maybe not in an undergraduate, but when I was, say, in graduate school, in the early to mid-1980s, already at that time, people said, well, COBOL is dead. Nobody wants to use COBOL. Why would anybody want to run COBOL? Okay, it was 30-something years ago. And guess what? It's still alive. And well, because there are a lot of programs written. And you know, you keep replacing computers, hardware dies. Software lives on. Okay? And somebody still has to maintain that software. And you have all those applications in banks, in insurance companies, that still run COBOL, and probably will do it for the foreseeable future. So all those early accounting programs, payroll, inventory management, general ledger processing, were written in COBOL. Okay? We'll talk about the problems with that, because everyone was a custom-made product. It's like, imagine you want a certain machine, and every time you want the machine, it has to be handcrafted for you. So that's basically how it was done. So there was off-the-shelf software, but it was the domain of much smaller players at that time. And that software also was limited in how much it could do. The beauty of COBOL was that, you know, you called the shots. So you would hire your own COBOL programmers. And if you want, say, to get a report of how many shirts you sell by color, even if your system was not originally designed, you would actually write a request to your information processing department. It may take a while, you know, they can take their sweet time and they will work on it for a couple of months. But after that, they will deliver a program that you can run periodically, and it will calculate for you how many shirts you sold by color. So this is what the standard package could be. So when you buy those simpler systems for smaller businesses that computerize bookkeeping, yeah, they will calculate the financial statements. And they will do it very well. And they will give you some additional reports, but was very, very limited. By the way, I can tell you that even 20 years ago, say at that time, Peachtree was very popular for small businesses. So there was even like a cottage industry in the late 1990s of some small CPA shops, mom and pop CPA shops that served in the area small businesses. Some of those guys actually specialized in writing different scripts for Peachtree to create some specialized reports for their clients. So again, all that is history by now, but it's very interesting. So, what are the advantages of computerized bookkeeping? Well, clearly, you automate everything. Great. When you get something which is off the shelf, as always, so if you buy something standardized, it will cost less. So those are very affordable. I don't even know how much is QuickBooks these days. I don't know. I can tell you that those packages would sell typically for small businesses, it's a few hundred bucks. So it's just not a major business expense. Recorded, generated standard reports, really well. Many of them actually have built-in backup features, so if you run them properly, even if your computer crashes, you should be okay because you have backup. We'll talk later about the backup. So what's the problem with all the standard packages? Again, designed just to support standard activities. You will hear this expression more often in the future, because here we talk about ad hoc webs. Have you heard this expression before? So what is an ad hoc query? This is typically a certain report that you want to get from the system that you cannot anticipate. You cannot know in advance what you want. Okay, so for example, you keep selling shirts, and you knew about the importance of size, and you had the standard, you had a report pre-built to report to you on the results of sales by size. And then all of a sudden, you realize that the color plays a critical role in your product. So it just dawns on you. So you didn't realize it in advance. And now you want the report by color. And maybe by color and by size. And you, it just came to you that you now need it. So this is what an ad hoc query is. It's a big deal if you can have an accounting information system that can answer ad hoc queries. Why is it important? Well, because it's impossible to anticipate all your future information needs. You can be better at that, you can be deliberate, you try to plan as much as you can, but inevitably something will come up. So we'll talk about this, and you will see that we have actually made great advances in this. But I can tell you that even today, ad hoc queries, true ad hoc queries, present the challenge. So we can handle it at a certain cost, but it may be a challenge. Much later in the course, probably after we discuss the material in chapter 8 and chapter 9, we'll get back to this and talk again about this challenge, that can we really, even with all the modern powerful computers, can we give assurance that no matter what those future questions are, no matter what kind of information needs our stakeholders have, we can answer any queries. So it's still a challenge. So most often they use proprietary file management, data management systems. On the previous slide, you saw something called D3. That was a special same database engine for D3, so there were other things like that. It was okay for small programs, not really appropriate for big things. Cross-functional queries. So, well, again, that's an important thing, cross-functional queries. So why? Well, because an enterprise, by its own nature, is an integrated creature. And when you create the so-called functional silos, this is what they're called. So I'm from purchasing, right? I'm from purchasing, I deal with vendors, right? I evaluate against their quotations, I evaluate how they do the delivery of goods. I cannot care less about salespeople. So I have no access to their sales systems, they have no access to my systems. We are completely separate. Now, this is actually detrimental to your business. So we have to make sure that an enterprise runs smoothly. So therefore, cross-functional integrations. So those were the driving forces behind the modern approach. Okay. And all this converged, we'll talk more about this later, on the so-called database management systems. So special systems designed to capture and store data. And inevitably, all the modern enterprise systems are database driven. No matter where you go, what company you work for, pretty much all their systems today will be database driven as opposed to file based. So we'll make more of this distinction probably in chapter 6 when we talk about the difference between client-based systems and database systems. Now, when you're dealing with database systems even today, you will see two different types. You will see homegrown systems, probably built on top of standard databases, say an Oracle database or Microsoft SQL Server, or maybe IBM DB2, typically depending on the underlying hardware platform. But they're always database driven. So what? Even if they are homegrown. Or you can see package systems. But these new packages are nothing like those old simple bookkeeping systems. These modern packages are called Enterprise Resource Planning Systems, ERPs. And they have proliferated in about, I would say, last 25 years. So this ERP revolution is about 25 years old. It started in the early 1990s and really picked up steam in the second half of the 90s. So from that point of view, the age of mass ERP deployments is about 20 years. From the second half of the 1990s until today. And this is what most companies run. The very last chapter of this core, of the main textbook in this class, is chapter 14, will be devoted to this discussion of these enterprise resource planning systems. These systems are very sophisticated and they're designed to support huge enterprises. And by huge enterprises, I'm talking about organizations where you can have tens, often hundreds of thousands of simultaneous users. So these are mind-boggling numbers. So we're talking about systems designed to handle requests submitted all the time by that enormous number of users. So, and this is what those modern ERP systems do. And of course, you cannot design it just to sit on a single computer and do this. These are the so-called multi-tier systems. At the very basic, you will see that they consist of three tiers. At the foundation of the system, there is the database. Still, in the foundation is a relational database. That's a given. You cannot get rid of it. It's going to be everywhere. Then you have the so-called application level. This is where you have computers crunching what we call these days business logic. That they know that all the business rules and how transactions can be processed. And on top of that is the so-called presentation layer. Those are the computers with whom individual users work. So you see a program on your computer when you work, say, with SAP, even if it is in a special program or it is in the browser, but it doesn't run on your computer. So you just work with that program, but what it does, it sends all those requests to the application servers. Those application servers do the heaviest number crunching. And when they're done with that heaviest number crunching, they will send the information or get the information from the database. Okay? So there is this stage interaction that most people who work with it may not even be aware of that this is happening. Only when the response time starts going down and the system becomes sluggish, then they may call somebody and say, oh, well, we have a problem with the database. And they will tell them the problem. So, huge systems, major software vendors actually make them. The biggest ones, have you heard SAP? The word SAP? Nobody has heard SAP. So, it's one of the largest, it's actually a German company. They're all international companies in this case. Among the American companies, the biggest one is actually is done by Oracle. Rogers, our enterprise, is run by Oracle. Microsoft makes a number of them. Okay, there is something called Microsoft Dynamics. You probably have never heard this, right? Not the kind of Microsoft product that you have heard. Yeah, that's, they actually have a whole family of Microsoft Dynamics systems. And there are others. So we'll talk about them. So they're very costly. We're talking usually about millions of dollars. Take very long time to implement, but they're very sticky. Meaning that if you decide to go with a certain vendor, it's so costly, takes such a long time, and so painful to replace it that you are usually stuck for a very long time, even if you don't really like it very much. So these systems are designed using the methodology that we will cover in this class. So all these systems now, and this is why we teach this class. So they are designed by means of modeling the business events. So you start from the ground and build them up. So they're designed to capture all the business events, and then you actually create all the necessary logic to support all the business functions. Okay. And as you will see, they are not really double-edged systems. You have pre-built reports, they will still create standard financial statements for you. You can still see all the account balances with their credits and their debits, and they even have special tables for that, but it's just an add-on. So the core of the system is enterprise-wide repository. And by the way, this repository is designed to hold absolutely everything. So you will see that this is not just financial data. So the repository in the central database will store all business relevant information. Okay? In some case, for example, customer complaints. Is it accounting? No. Well, it will affect your accounting numbers, right? Maybe you would want to process it, say, to calculate certain allowance amounts, right? For example, allowances for future warranty claims, right? Is that accounting? Well, in accrual accounting, yes, that's accounting. How do you know what it is? Do you pull it out of thin air? Well, you'd better not, right? So, again, the system is designed to be this all-encompassing, integrated. So the key word here, this is integration, cross-functional integration. This is an integrated system. It integrates all aspects of the enterprise. And you will see that it will support real-time capture, real-time updates, real-time reports. It will make your data visible across the enterprise. So you don't have to call other people to figure out what is going on. You can be given access and you will see in real time what is going on. And the key will be that the capture is at the source in the completely disaggregated form. So no filtering. When something happens, you simply faithfully record all the details, all the attributes of your data. And everybody now uses it. So whether you will be, say, work for the corporate controller, whether you will become a public auditor, whether you will actually work for a consulting organization. So you all work with these systems. Again, so you are all information professionals that will focus on internal controls. Again, GAAP is important. We'll talk more about auditing. We have a separate chapter about auditing and chapter 11.